Hello, dearest friends, how are you? I would like to read a little bit from the writings of Rabbi Isaac Luria. It's writings that actually were written around 500 years ago in the city of Safed. And there's a lot of deep and tremendous knowledge that we can gain from these writings. So today we're going to read about the days of Purim. Purim is a holiday that we're going to celebrate soon. And we'd like to learn what Rabbi Isaac Luria, the ARI, have to tell us about Purim. I have it only in Hebrew, so I'm going to read for you and translate. So he says, I'm going to explain the idea, the secret of Purim, the scroll that we're reading, Mordecai and Esther, and the charity that we give on Purim, and the special feast, special meal, and happiness on Purim. Okay. So he says, if we are familiar a little bit with the story happened around 2500 years ago. It was the time that the people of Israel lived in Israel. Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, he took over Jerusalem, he destroyed the temple, and he took the people of Israel to exile to the area where today is like Iraq and Iran, what we call Babylon. And they've been there for 70 years in Babylon. In the end of the 70 years, approximately toward the end of the 70 years, that's where the time, the story of Purim took place in Persia. What was the whole idea? What was the whole purpose? The whole purpose was to basically remind the people they're supposed to go back to Israel to build the temple again, in order to bring the light of God to the entire world. But what's happening is, sometimes all of us, you know, first of all, to realize why the exile happened from the first place. And the reason was because people had everything. They had the temple. They had beautiful life. And when you have a lot of blessings in your life, sometimes you tend to forget and to take for granted and not to really deeply appreciate. Sometimes you start to take it for granted. And the whole idea of the spiritual walk is to have a connection with God that called face to face. Face-to-face means that your desire is constantly to connect to the Creator. And it says that the Zeranpin was spiritually asleep. What is Zeranpin? Zeranpin is this, it's a word in Aramaic that describe the energy inside a human being that the energy, the godly energy inside a human being. What is the energy of God? We're learning from Rabbi Ashlag, the energy of God is the energy of sharing and caring and loving. So when a person wants to connect to God, Rabbi Ashlag explains, you need to awake your Zeranpin. You need to awake your desire to share, to influence good. And by doing that, you have affinity with the Creator, you're becoming unified with God. Now, when things, when there's, you know, things just happening and there's good things in life, we tend to not always push ourselves beyond our comfort zone to share and to care in order to have a strong connection to God, because things are already happening. Things are already kind of, you know, I'm fulfilled. Why I need to push myself beyond my limit? And the idea is that we came to this world in order to earn a strong and deep face-to-face connection with God. And when we're forgetting it, and when we forget that that's the purpose, and we don't push ourselves enough, we don't awake our zeh and pin strongly enough, then we start to focus on receiving. We start to focus on, you know, what I can have, what I can take from every situation. And then I have this similarity from the Creator, and as a result, I'm getting further away, or what we call back to back. That instead that your connection to God will be face to face, it's like back to back. Like, yes, I know that there is God, but, you know, it's like I have so many things that I'm busy with. I don't have time for that connection with God because I need to do so many things in my life. It's back to back, right? Sometimes, again, in order to create a face-to-face relationship again, need to be what he calls here Nesira, which means a sewing, kind of a spiritual surgery. That the purpose of that surgery is to remove the layers between you and the Creator, what we call in Hebrew klipot. Same way that in a surgery, they're taking different things that, you know, that blocking the person and allow the body to be healthy. They're taking, you know, different kind of things. It can be like a tumor, or it can be something else. And then person can live again in a healthy way. So when there is klipot, it's creating a blockage between us and the Creator, and need to go through a special kind of sewing, special kind of surgery to take those klipot out, so I can have again a strong connection to God. And what's happening through this kind of surgery, the same way that in a surgery, a hospital, they're doing like anesthesia in order to, you know, put the conscious part of the body asleep so the person would not feel anything during the procedure, during the surgery. In the same way, sometimes people going through kind of a spiritual sleeping, and that's what happened to the people in Persia back then. They fell asleep spiritually. Why? In order that they'll be able to go through this special surgery, and as a result, to have a strong and deep yearning to the Creator all over again. And that's why it says that this evil guy, his name was Haman, he told the king called Ahasuerus, thing in English, they call him Xerox. Both of them were actually evil people. And Haman, his purpose, by the way, Rabbi Isaac Liras says that he was an astrologer. And he could see that right now there's a time that the people of Israel are asleep spiritually. And when you are asleep spiritually, you know, means if you don't push yourself to share and to care and to love, so you don't have affinity with the life force of God. And that's why you don't see blessings as you would like to see. And Haman could say that. Haman could see that the people of Israel are spiritually asleep. They don't push themselves strongly enough to share with others, to care for others. And as a result, he thought to himself, that's the time, especially that he could also see it in the stars. He thought to himself, that's the time that we can destroy them, because they don't have that special kind of revelation of the light force of God protecting them. And it says that Haman and his 10 sons represented those 10 layers of klipa, shells, that covering. Let's continue a little bit more. But Rabbi Isaac Luria actually says that this spiritual sleeping, even though it sounds like not such a good thing to spiritually sleep, but eventually it was for the benefit of the people of Israel. I can tell you that it's very similar to what's happening here now in Israel. Before October 7, on October 6, the people of Israel were pretty much asleep. Again, what does it mean asleep? People of Israel need to remember that they have a special mission to remind all the people of the world about God. To not just to remind, to teach the entire world how to connect to God in a deep way. Through sharing and through loving and through unconditional love. Now, even here in Israel, people kind of were spiritually asleep. Every person were kind of, you know, focused on what I want. It's like, from political point of view, from this point of view, arguing, everyone kind of pulling to his side. How I want things to be, you know? And people were pretty much spiritually asleep, kind of not really interested so much in our mission in the world as the people of Israel, in a deeper way, how to connect to God, how to fulfill what God is asking from us. Not so much, not enough, let's say. After the October 7 attack, which the Hamas basically, they are the descendants of the Amalek. There's different ways how to know that. The cruelty that they behave, only the nation of Amalek could do those things. Anyway, so it says that, you know, so what happened here, that after the attack, suddenly, here in Israel, everyone woke up, kind of. That's how people say, we woke up. We realize something that, we realize that we were asleep, basically. That's what people say here. From different aspects, point of view. People started to share with each other. And people started to, you know, get something deeper, open up in the desire of people to connect to God. All over Israel. I think also all over the world, actually. And also, many people started to be more patient with each other, to listen. What's interesting in Israel, there's a lot of, you know, people, there's so many different type of groups here. Because Israel, approximately 70-something years ago when it was established, the people that immigrated to Israel were the children of Israel that basically were in exile for 2,000 years. So there were people came from Poland, Romania, Bulgaria. It's like unbelievable. So many countries in a matter of few years, you know. Morocco, Tunisia, Algeria. And by the way, that's very interesting that all this that I'm mentioning now, it's already written in the prophets thousands of years ago, that that's what actually going to happen. Yemen, Saudi Arabia, Iraq, Germany, Greece, like all over Europe, all over the area of Russia and Ukraine and all those countries, countries in North Africa, French, Spain. Again, I said already Morocco, different Arab countries, like from really literally all around the world, and so much kind of differences of culture and different kind of things, and above all these, a lot of very extreme kind of opinions about in politics. Why? Because there's the religious people and they're not religious. And this type of religious and that type of religion, all together, it created a lot of differences that caused everyone to just pull to his side. And after October 7th, I'm sorry, something opened up in the mind of people to actually say, let's listen to the other side. Let's see the good within them. Let's concentrate on how we can get united and support each other and help each other. And that's the whole purpose of the spiritual world. So eventually, Rabbi Isaac Luria says here in his writings that the whole sleeping that the people wore, eventually it helped them through the sleeping, because they were sleeping. Okay. So again, what's happening when sleeping is basically like this anesthesia that we talked about. It's like basically spiritual kind of sleeping. Eventually, there's a special procedure of surgery that God is doing, helps us to remove the klipot, those veils, and as a result, the connection to God is even deeper and stronger than before. And that's exactly also what happened back in Persia, 2,500 years ago. And it's also what's happening right now in these days in Israel and actually all around the world. And what's interesting is that it's in the scroll of Esther, after the whole situation, the whole story of Esther happened, and even the children of Haman were hanged, Esther is coming back to the king. But it says in the scroll that when it says there's sometimes it says the king Xerox, but sometimes it just says the king. And it says that when it says the king, it's not talking about King Xerox, but it's talking about the king of the world. It's talking about God. And it says that after the whole situation happened, Esther is approaching the king and asking him for to help when this Purim gonna happen again. What does Esther means? She talking about our time, our era. She talked about, without getting into the whole situation, into the whole story, but it's interesting that the Holocaust again happened just before the people came back to Israel. It's exactly like in the story of Persia, that the whole story of Purim happened just before people came back to Israel and built the temple. And the Nazis are descendants of the Amalek. And also, again, it's happening all over again with Hamas. But see, from what the Nazis did, even though it was a horrible thing, but from this tremendous pain, people woke up in such a deep way in their desire to connect to God, in their desire to go to Israel and to build Israel in order to help to bring the message of love and peace and harmony to the entire world. Yes. And it says that the Haman and Xerox, their whole purpose was to make sure to kill the people so they would never be able to go back again and to build the temple in Jerusalem. It's interesting that in the different booklets of the IDF soldiers came into Gaza and they entered the schools and they saw that all the kids had like those notebooks with the picture of Al-Aqsa. Al-Aqsa is like that mosque on top of the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. And the whole idea of the Hamas is to prevent the people of Israel to build the Holy Temple. We know that the people of Israel would not build the Holy Temple. It says in the prophets that in the right time, God will bring the Holy Temple from the heavens. So why the Hamas would do anything that we would not build the temple? Just a second. If the temple is a channel of light, to bring peace and harmony to all humanity, so why are they so afraid for the temple? It's only going to benefit as well themselves. Because again, when a person coming from place of darkness, he cannot stand the light. It's like a bat in a cave. If you shine with like this flashlight, he's gonna start to scream. They don't like the light. They don't like the light of the sun. So when a person is completely in the darkness, like the Hamas, like Amalek, when you bring them the Holy Temple, when you bring them the light of holiness, of good in the world, it's actually for them, it's horrible. They cannot stand it. So that's why they wanted to prevent the people to actually build a temple. הנה אף בזמן הדורמית העין הקבע ישנה כאיזה מסתלקים ומוכים וזרמפים נכנסים בנקבה. Little bit more we'll read. Okay, next time we'll continue to read a little bit more about Purim. It was a pleasure to study with you. Thank you very much. Take care. Blessings.